Professor Koskos, prominent professors, dear friends. Indeed, it is a great pleasure for me to be here in this very important gathering and to be part of this very important conference. I am especially thankful to you, President of the Hellenic-American University, for this invitation. You know that I'm on my way to the United States, and I had a short layover in Athens in order to be part of this very important meeting, in this very same place where I have spent some years of my youth. Maybe you don't know that, but I was a student of this institution some years ago. Well, I would like to congratulate you for this initiative, which demonstrates yet again the values of this institution, the values of this university, but also the central, pivotal role of all universities participating in the dialogue that started on addressing the challenges of our times. Central among those, the future of Europe and the Euro-Atlantic relations. We all know that we are at a historic juncture where both Europe and the United States are at crossroads. I'm not going today to further elaborate on the EU-US relations today. Just one day after an important informal European summit in Salzburg, the focus is of course on the internal policies that will define our common future. I would like to nevertheless underline that both the European Union and the United States are confronted with huge challenges, but with a common denominator. They are challenges very close to our citizens' concerns in both sides of the Atlantic. I work closely during the last 4 years with our United States partners to deepen our cooperation. I am even more optimistic about it following the successful meeting, the successful visit of President Juncker in Washington 1 month ago with President Trump. That ended a trade war before it has even started. On a daily basis, we are all recipients of worrying news. News which bring to mind difficult times for today's generations and even more difficult for the next ones. Without doubt, these are times that require a strong sense of responsibility, bold decisions, and clear-cut political choices. Citizens, as you very correctly said before, are worried, and they are fully justified in seeking reliable answers and solutions to break free from the uncertainty and insecurity which everywhere around us is living. Today, 60 years after the establishment, the creation of the European community at that time, Europe is experiencing the first earthquake at its very foundations. Coming in the wake of the economic crisis, the unprecedented migratory flows and the parallel crisis from consecutive terrorist attacks are calling our fundamentals into question. Europe was not prepared, was not ready to face this parallel crisis. The Union and Member States were totally unprepared. So Europe was taken by surprise in the year 2015. And it took some time to realize that there is really a crisis ahead. The basic principles upon which the European project is built, those of solidarity and responsibility, are being shaken and questioned. Without these very principles, however, there can be no Europe. It is our duty to defend and protect these principles. As the generation that inherited the vision of Schumann and Monet, and this is what we strive to do as guardians of the treaties. All European leaders need to realize this responsibility and do the same. I have the responsibility to handle our response to the parallel crisis on migration and internal security in the name of the United Europe. And I will be frank, not always under the easiest conditions in terms of understanding and cooperation with some European governments. Here I make a distinction between member states and governments. It's better to avoid referring to member states. But governments should know that they come and go. The states will be there. From the ashes of the two world wars, the vision of these great visionaries, leaders of that time, like Schumann and Monet, prudent, visionary, and determined personalities and leaders, have built a Europe of peace, democracy, stability, and progress. They left behind the traumatic experiences of centuries past and fought to build a union of states on the basis of solidarity and responsibility. It's good to know that the term solidarity is enshrined in the founding text of the treaties 17 times. And of course, shared and pooled sovereignty. Consensus and shared decision making over conflict and division. These principles are not simply ethical norms. They are legally binding on all member states that have agreed and accepted the founding treaties of the Union. Today, 60 years after the signing of the Treaty of Rome, these principles, as I said before, are being questioned. The dark forces of populism and nationalism are throwing them into doubt. They do so knowingly, undermining the European project. Almost oblivious of the past, they take prosperity, democracy, and progress for granted. Some governments, looking only inwards and ignoring their historical responsibilities, have deliberately created favorable ground for Euroscepticism, introducing populism into everyday political discourse. In doing this, they are turning their back to fundamental European principles and values, such as the rule of law, solidarity, and shared responsibility. This historical hubris is the consequence of Europe's biggest crisis to date, an existential crisis. For the first time in its history, our Union is getting smaller as one member decided to abandon it. But this does not make us weaker. On the contrary, the member states are sending a strong signal every day in favor of our democracy and of our common European path by showing respect to the principles of solidarity and diversity. The recent tragic events stunned our societies and cultivated and fostered fear. Our aim is to protect Europe and safeguard the security of our citizens. At the same time, we must continue to defend openness and tolerance, which constitute the basis of the European edifice. It is no exaggeration to say that the way we handle this parallel crisis of migration and security will, to a large extent, also determine the future of the Union. Some believed that the Union would be challenged by the severe financial crisis. It turns out that the real challenge of this era in history is the migration crisis. And this because this crisis has threatened the two fundamental principles I mentioned before. Migration is therefore a key priority for us. That is why the President of the Commission, President Juncker, decided to create the migration portfolio for the very first time in the year 2014 and appointed the first Commissioner for Migration. The Commissioner was approved by and confirmed by the European Parliament. Believe me, it was an honor, but also a great responsibility and a particular challenge for me to take up this very important endeavor. Because as a citizen of Greece, I'm at the very heart of the migration crisis. And as mayor of Athens at that time, I had experienced for the very first time what does it mean for a hosting city, for a hosting country, to open its doors to a big number of Albanians who at that time fled their country after the collapse of communism. We are making every possible effort, and we are working towards promoting a common European approach in order to deal with migration, a phenomenon that will be here for many, many decades ahead. Whether we want to admit it or not, to accept it or not, we are living the era of human mobility. It's good to know that right now more than 75 million people are refugees somewhere in the world, and more than 260 million they're migrants seeking for a better life somewhere in the world. That's why it has become a global issue. And just 3 years ago, I took the initiative to meet the former Secretary General of the United Nations and propose to convene in New York an extraordinary General Assembly on migration, something that happened. And as you remember, the same time President Obama had done the same. So the whole world's globalized. But Europe is in the epicenter of this movement. This also reflects the will of most citizens, as according to the recent Eurobarometer, the majority of Europeans want a common European solution to migration, and this is what we have been trying to do during the last 3 years. We have made significant progress in the area of migration, but much more has to be done. From the very first moment, we have stepped up our efforts and succeeded in adopting, for the first time in Europe, the European agenda on migration. We did not only address immediate challenges, but proposed a long-term strategy. It is important that we move forward and manage this phenomenon in a sustainable and effective manner. Europe needs to be better prepared for any possible future crisis because we don't know what the future is holding for us. You know that we live in a very unstable period. An arc of instability stretches from Tunisia to Ukraine. And since we're in Greece, it's good for us in Greece to know that we are very close to the very heart of this unstable geopolitical environment. Coming back to migration, the reform of the common European asylum system is still our priority. We must strike the right balance between responsibility and solidarity. We need a more harmonized and efficient system where burdens are shared equally and fairly, where all member states will have the same reception conditions and apply the same asylum procedures. We must continue our action, first of all, to save lives. It's our human duty. Protecting migrant children, creating safe and legal pathways to Europe, protecting our external borders, fighting criminal networks of traffickers, and effectively returning those who do not have the right to stay in the European Union. Our returns policy and how effective it is also a crucial element. Returns are an important factor towards preventing irregular migration. Working together, the Union will put more pressure on third countries to ensure their cooperation on readmission and returns. I have been traveling from the one top of Africa to the other in order to negotiate with governments of these countries, first of all, to take back their own citizens, and second, to cooperate with us, because you shouldn't forget that Europe is the main donor in terms of development of these countries. So we have very strong leverages in our hands to convince them, but we treat them in a very respectful way. The colonial times have finished. And this is something that some leaders in Europe should understand, who believe that discussing issues with Africa, they can treat the African governments as they were doing 2 centuries ago. But Europe is showing the way. We must admit and acknowledge that the migratory flows will not going to subside easily. We know that. Stabilization can only be achieved on a long-term basis with structural, deep structural reforms. An important step towards this direction is the successful implementation so far of the so-called EU-Turkey statement, which has greatly reduced irregular arrivals in the Eastern Mediterranean. I remind you that in the year 2015 and 16, more than 13,000, 14,000 people every day were crossing the European borders of the Aegean Sea. Now the numbers have gone down dramatically thanks to the implementation of this statement. And I want to clarify one thing for our prominent professors who are here. We do not talk about an agreement, because an agreement had to be ratified by national parliaments, and this would never happen. So we were quite resourceful in ideas, and we discovered this method, which is a statement, but Turkey is respecting this statement. In addition to our cooperation with Turkey, similar project cannot be implemented with other countries, because some, maybe you read in the newspapers, are proposed to do the same thing with Libya, but in Libya the situation is chaotic. I was in Libya, you know, I was among the ones who dared to land in the, at the airport of Tripoli, an experience that they will never forget, because in order to discuss with the local recognized international government, the poor minister, in order to come and join us at the airport, he had to cross 10 checkpoints by 10 uncontrolled militias who have full control of the country, including, of course, the smugglers' networks. So it's difficult to do it there. So in addition to that, with Turkey, we are stepping up our efforts in the central Mediterranean route. It is important for Europe to show solidarity to Africa and to address the root causes of migration. Closer cooperation with third countries on all aspects of migration is a necessity. Regarding now legal migration, Europe is a continent that is aging, as you know, with skill shortages in important sectors of our economy. We shall be in need very soon of a big number of migrants. But the ones who want to come to Europe must follow legal pathways, something that was not existing before, because as I said in the beginning, there was no migration policy in Europe. Only a few member states had an experience of that. For the rest of the countries, we had an experience of sending migrants abroad, Italy, Greece, Spain, but not in receiving. And this is what we have changed during the last 3 years. We have to create legal channels for migration, those that the European economy needs, and complement our efforts to fully activate the existing EU workforce. Economic migration is not and should not be irregular. Providing protection to those in need is our moral and legal obligation. The challenges of migration will continue to shape the future of Europe, as I said in the beginning. At the same time, mobility is a basic element of our times. We cannot stop it, but we can manage it more efficiently. For this reason, we have proposed to enhance and protect Schengen, which allows to more than 400 million people to move across Europe freely. I belong to a generation which has experienced in the past having their passport stamped, and when I was coming back, have it replaced, and long queues at the passport controls, and even uncertainty when crossing European borders. We should preserve and defend Schengen. Schengen is the greatest and more tangible example of European integration. Younger people who are in this audience today had never lived what I had lived as member of the previous generations. So it is our duty to uphold and defend Schengen. Schengen is at stake because of the migration and refugee crisis. I know you know that I am responsible for the Schengen zone in Europe, and I have gone through difficult moments in trying to find a solution with some member states who want to reintroduce internal border controls for security reasons, but also linked to migration. As I said, we have gone through difficult times because some member states believe that they should reintroduce border controls while migration is their main concern. Schengen, however, continues to exist. I will not hide behind empty words. If Schengen collapses, it will be the beginning of the end for the European Union as we know it today. Some also used the successive terrorist attacks to justify insularity and closed borders. But you cannot fight ideas with borders, walls, and barbed wire. Most of the attacks in Europe were committed by homeborn and raised in our societies, citizens of these countries. Homegrown. This is a big question. Why it happened? People that bought into poisonous propaganda and took up arms against their fellow citizens. European citizens that were radicalized overnight into do-it-yourself terrorism. It is these ideas that we fight while depriving terrorists the space, means, and resources to commit their hateful acts. I have been trying a lot during the last 2 years to convince member states to cooperate, exchange information, to deepen trust among them. But I want to be frank and clear with you. Unfortunately, the deep state still resists in Europe. This is why, in front of this big problem, 2.5 years ago, we decided to put forward the bold idea of a security union in Europe. I'd like to tell you that when I took office, at the doorstep statement in Brussels once, I said it's the moment for the European intelligence service to work closer to each other, and why not to set up a European FBI. Some countries accepted it, some others did not, because, as I said, the deep state reacted. I will not mention, I will not name the countries now, because they have changed their ideas, unfortunately, following what they have experienced with these horrendous terrorist attacks. But it was late. Anyway, we work on that. A union of trust and cooperation across borders, where the security of one member state is the security of all member states. I want you to know that if the security authorities of member states had started cooperation a bit earlier, the ones who perpetrated these terrorist attacks in Paris, Bataclan, would have been intercepted and arrested before they arrived there. They managed to cross 3 member states of the European Union and 3 Balkan states, arrive in Brussels, set up their headquarters, and commit their terrorist attacks. So we need cooperation, sharing information and intelligence. A union of trust and cooperation across borders, where the security, as I said, is our top priority. Where one member state's information is not jealously guarded in national silos, but where it is shared and used to the maximum to prevent developing threats across the European Union and in our wider neighborhood. I was there yesterday in Belgrade in a conference on cybersecurity, and that was the message I sent to all leaders of the so-called Western Balkans region. Start cooperating with us, exchange information, get rid of all these rivalries of the past, and do not let do not allow Balkans to get re-Balkanized by opening the door to nationalism and populism. I'm afraid we have to work hard over there, and I say that here in Athens because what I told you right now is happening just across the Greek borders, but at the same time European borders. This is how we are working now: to enhance the cooperation among police authorities and intelligence services, to improve our information systems and their interoperability, to create and take advantage of tools to prevent terrorist movements, their access to means and material for terrorist attacks, and to stop them from spreading terrorist propaganda on the internet. And it is exactly the internet, dear friends, that is the most important battleground against terrorism. Because Daesh was defeated on the ground, but not on internet. That's where we need to eliminate the presence of terrorism first, to deprive it of the Eurochamber it needs to recruit, to radicalize, and to glorify its atrocities. This was exactly our objective in the year 2015, when I took the initiative to found the EU Internet Forum with all the major internet players in a voluntary partnership based on trust and cooperation. And I can tell you that all these big platforms like Microsoft, Google, Facebook, Twitter, they cooperated with us. And we have seen the very first tangible results. But the cooperation based on trust. Now, we take this work one step further with strong rules to ensure that all internet companies, including the smaller ones, cooperate against terrorism, and not only the ones that joined the EU Internet Forum. Some months ago in New York, in a very special meeting, President Macron, Prime Minister Theresa May, myself, we all decided to set up the Global Internet Forum, having one and only aim: to fight terrorism across the world. And it works. Some people are concerned because they feel that national competencies are being transferred to Brussels. I want to be clear. Europe is not something abstract. It is easy and at the same time irresponsible and populistic to always criticize the European Union institutions. Europe consists of all of us: governments, politicians, media, academia, citizens, political parties, and the private sector. The success of the European endeavor depends on the common responsibility. To be strong, we have to stay united. This is the essence of our union: to become better together. We cannot take for granted what we have achieved so far. The best choice is to move forward together, all the 27 member states of the European Union. Splitting or moving towards different directions is not an option, and it will prove itself disastrous in the future. Because Europe is confronted with one more challenge, with one more threat: to revert to its recent dark past. Of course, yes, we cannot become overnight a federal Europe. We can nevertheless have federal type functions in migration security, in defense, in economy, and our external policy, something that does not exist today. This approach will always be in line with the basic principles of the treaties, our common values, and obligation for solidarity between the member states and the citizens. So, in this very existential moment, there is only one way ahead: moving Europe forward, deepening our cooperation, consolidating the European institutions, and start fostering the European consciousness among our citizens. The only way to move forward is to support and further enhance European integration. As far as our country, Greece, is concerned, Europe was a catalyst to implement significant and structural reforms. The last 35 years, Greece has managed to achieve very significant progress thanks to the support of the European Union. Nevertheless, we should not overlook our responsibility to make Greece a modern European state. And in order to do it, we have to do it all together. I don't know whether the economists in this room agree with me, but the real source of the economic crisis in Greece was not its real economy. It was this anachronistic function of this state that we have to change and restore. This is a responsibility that all the citizens of Greece equally share, beyond political parties or personal opinions. This responsibility remains crucial and probably explains why this genuine European member state, like Greece, a historic and cultural fundament of Europe, still tries to get out of the crisis. However, getting out of the crisis can only be done through the European way, which is the only that can guarantee a better future for our country and ensure more security, stability, deepening of our democratic institutions, and peace for our country and for the region. Greece, as a member of the European family, of the European Union, is called to make good use of its historic and geopolitical position. Its political and cultural bonds with the European family and the neighboring nations play a responsible role as a geopolitical pillar of stability. Greece is called to undertake this global approach to its relations and position in Europe by contributing to the overall collective effort to enhance and complete the European endeavor. The European family has always managed to get out of its internal crisis stronger because it always solved its problems through dialogue and compromise in a spirit of unity and solidarity. This is the essence of the European endeavor. This is what our democratic values stand for. The future generations will judge us harshly if we allow to return to the dark past, the times of division, nationalism, closed borders, and possibly wars. It is our duty towards the future generations to empower Europe and keep alive the European vision. Most of the challenges we are confronted with today are common and do not stop at borders. Only if we work together, we can protect and secure the interests of our countries and our citizens. The future of Europe emerges from its past and history, which has proven that the only way forward is a stronger European Union. Dear friends, as I said, we're at a crossroad. It's a moment for responsibility for all of us. We shouldn't take for granted what has been inherited to us by the previous generations. Maybe we have not realized, and I think the majority of all of you here have lived it, that we are the privileged generation of mankind's history. We are the only ones who have not lived a war. Our fathers and our grandfathers did so. Do not allow to go back to revert to these dark moments. Marx said, I want to be clear, I'm not a Marxist, but Marx said that history repeats itself. He's wrong. History, it does not repeat itself. Men repeat history when they don't read it and they don't draw lessons from it. Thank you.